First, I'd like to thank the organizer, especially Professor Yonjitsu, for inviting me and giving me an opportunity to talk at this nice international conference. Okay, today I will talk about Hopf hypersurfaces in non-flat complex spaceform, which is slightly changed from initial one. Okay. So first, I will talk about some basic concepts and basic facts and motivation of this talk. So first, let sigma 2n minus 1 be a real hypersurface in a Kähler manifold M tilde and use the complex dimension of Kähler manifolds. And we denote n as a locally defined unit normal vector field of sigma in M tilde. Difference of codimension of sigma 2n minus 1 is equal to 1. So normal space is, dimension of normal space is 1. So we take a locally defined unit normal vector field n. Then structure vector of sigma is defined by this form, where J is a complex structure of Kähler manifolds. And then we can see that this vector C is a tangent vector of real hypersurface, you know. So where J is a complex structure of M tilde. This vector plays an important role to investigate real hypersurfaces, you know. So we introduce a main subject of this talk as a Hopf hypersurface in complex spaceforms. We denote M tilde C as a complex spaceform of constant holomorphic sectional curvature C, and let M be a real hypersurface in this complex spaceform. And such hypersurface is called Hopf if the structure vector C is an eigenvector of the shape operator A of the real hypersurface M. That means AXC is equal to some function mu times C. And it is well known that when the curvature of the ambient space is non-zero, then the corresponding principal curvature mu, which is also now we call such value mu, is a Hopf curvature of C, of Hopf hypersurface M in M tilde C, is a constant. In positive case, that fact is proved by Yoshiaki Maeda, and it is well known that negative case, which is proved by Professor Kiyansu. And with respect to Hopf hypersurface, very well-known result is proved by Cecil and Ryan, which is some kind of structure theorem for Hopf hypersurface. And they prove that Hopf hypersurface M with Hopf curvature mu, which we write such value as 2 times cotangent 2r, by taking a suitable orientation, we may write Hopf curvature mu as this form. And we assume that the constant holomorphic sectional curvature of the Fubini-Study metric of complex projective space is equal to 4. Then, such a Hopf hypersurface M lies on a tube of radius R over complex manifold in CPN, provided that the focal map from M to CPN, which introduced by previous talk by Professor Onita, that such focal map has constant rank on M. We know that a tube means that, of course, that first we take a complex manifold in complex projective space, and the next take a tubular neighborhood of complex manifolds. Then boundary of such tubular neighborhood is nothing but this tube. So, very roughly speaking, Hopf hypersurface and complex spaceform, there's one correspondence. More precisely, first we take a complex spaceform, then next we take a tube, then such tube is, if it's a real hypersurface, then it is a Hopf hypersurface. And this Hopf Sessler's theorem states kind of converse, you know. So next we think negative curvature case in complex hyperbolic space. Professor Montero at Granada proved in 1995 that Hopf hypersurface in CH minus 4 with Hopf curvature mu satisfying absolute value of mu is greater than 2. For such Hopf hypersurface, he proved that also such Hopf hypersurface lies on the tube of radius r over complex spaceform in CHN. In this case, mu is equal to, mu is equal to 2 times cotangent hyperbolic to r. Mu and r is related by this equation. Provided that the rank of Hogarth map is constant as Cecil Ryan's theorem. We emphasize that this theorem holds only a large value for Hopf curvature. So until recently, such structure theorem for Hopf hypersurface with small Hopf curvature is not known until recently, but Thomas Ibe and also smallest dimensional case, Ibe and Ryan, proved in this paper that Hopf hypersurface with small Hopf curvature may be constructed from arbitrary pair of Legendrian submanifolds in odd dimensional sphere. They prove such a structure theorem. And so now I'd like to note that it seems very different. It looks like very different situation of this theorem and Montel's previous result, I think. And also, this theorem is proved by using some exterior differential systems. And the method is very, I think, analytic. So geometric meaning is, at least for me, very to find difficult. So I'd like to understand these objects as more geometrically. That is the motivation of this talk. So in this talk, I'd like to clarify the structure of Hopf hypersurfaces M in either complex projective space or complex hyperbolic space by using some Gauss maps from M to some Grassmannians, as previous Professor Oita's talk. In complex projective case, we consider map first if we have a Hopf hypersurface in CPN, then we have some Gauss map to a complex two-plane Grassmannian. And also, from a Hopf hypersurface in complex hyperbolic space, we take some Gauss map to some indefinite Grassmannians, you know. So first, we consider about Gauss map of real hypersurface in CPN. Let large phi be immersion from ordinary minus one dimensional manifold to CPN, and let NP be a normal vector at P. For each such point of real hypersurface, we put GP as this form. Yeah, this means that first, phi P is an element of CPN, and you know that CPN is a set of complex one-dimensional complex lines in CN plus one. So phi P, I mean that some one-dimensional complex line. You know? And also, CNP is a... so come on. complex line spanned by this indinormal vector. Then we have a complex two-plane in CN plus one. You know? Then we have a Gauss map from real hypersurface to complex two-plane Gauss manion of real hypersurface. So to describe result, we recall some geometric structures on this complex two-plane Gauss manion. As you know, this is a center of complex two-plane Gauss manion, so maybe most of you know. And it is known that, so we recall some facts about quaternion Euler manifolds. Let M tilde 4M and the metric G tilde and Q denotes let be a quaternion Euler manifold with the quaternion Euler structure G tilde and Q, which means that that G tilde is a Riemann metric of M tilde and Q is a rank 3 sub-bundle of endomorphism bundle over M tilde, which satisfies the following conditions. First, for each quaternion Euler manifold M tilde, there is a neighborhood U of P over which there is a local frame field of this rank 3 bundle I1 tilde, tilde 2 tilde, I3 tilde, satisfying these identities. This is also, you know, that similar to quaternions, pure imaginary quaternions. You know? And relationship of this quaternion QP and metric is as follows, which means that these structures spanned by I1 to I3 preserves a metric. You know? And also, the vector bundle Q is parallel in this endomorphism bundle with respect to the Riemannian collection, Navratilda associated with G tilde. And it is well known that complex two-plane Gauss manion is an example of such quaternion Euler manifold. You know. Of course, this manifold has also a complex structure, and this space has two distinct such structures. So next we think about some sub-manifolds in this quaternion Euler manifolds. So let M tilde be a quaternion Euler manifolds. And 2M dimensional sub-manifold of M tilde is said to be almost Hermitian if there is a section I tilde of the bundle Q restricted to M such that first I tilde square is equal to minus identity and I tilde preserves a tangent bundle of this sub-manifold which is defined by Alexeyevsky and Mathieu Fava at this paper. Since I tilde is a structure a tensor on M tilde, so we denote I, the almost complex structure on M induced from I tilde. You know? So evidently, MI with the induced metric G is an almost Hermitian manifold. And if, especially, MGI is a Keeler, we call it a Keeler sub-manifold of a quaternion Keeler manifold, M tilde. Then, also, another notion of summerhood is that all summation summerhood M together with a section I tilde of Q restricted to M is said to be totally complex if at each point of summerhood P we have this property for each section L in QP with L is orthogonal to this selected section. Then it is known that even dimensional almost Hermitian submanifold M to M is scalar if and only if it is totally complex. So we'd like to think about such submanifold. So first result is that let M to N minus B a real hypersurface in CPN and let G be the Gauss map as defined as previously. Suppose M is a Hopf hypersurface. Then image of this Gauss map is a real 2M minus N minus 2 dimensional totally complex summerhood in this complex two-plane Grassmannian. So here I like to note that of course original real hypersurface has odd dimension and this totally complex summerhood is even dimension. A difference is only one dimension. And so difference is occurred as that on this real hypersurface, each integral curve of structure vector field Xi, Hopf condition implies that such each integral curve is very good behavior. And so,
Gauss map is not
immersion. Ah, yes. So, each integral curve is integral curve. It's a geodesic circle from a point in CP1, which is also identified with this. And you know that complex Grassmannian is definitions of course the space of complex two-plane Grass subspace, set of two-plane linear subspace in CN plus one. But also if we take a project then we think this space as CP1 in CPN. Okay. Since each integral curve is lies in a fixed CP1, so on each integral curve of C, this map GM is constant. And we assert that it's on its orthogonal complement and the differential of G is non-degenerate. So image by implicit function theorem, image of G is a half-dimensional submanifold in this complex two-plane Grassmannian. And total complexness is deduced from some identity of Hopf hypersurface. You know, this is the first theorem. Okay. So next, I'd like to think about the converse of this theorem. So to do that, we think next some CP1 bundle over complex two-plane Grassmannian. Let E denotes a set of some orthogonal pair of one-dimensional lines. You know? Then E is considered as some homogeneous space and also generalized fragmanifold. Yes. Okay. The also is also think about a total space of some CP1 bundle over complex two-plane Grassmannian with this projection. Namely, since E is a set of such pair of two orthogonal lines, then maps to some complex plane spanned by these two orthogonal lines. Then we have a map from it to this complex plane Grassmannian. And this gives us a CP1 band structure over spring Grassmannian. So each fiber of this projection is identified with the base point of complex Grassmannian. We identify this space as the set of this totally geodesic complex projective lines, you know. And also we have another projection from this space E to CPN by mapping a pair of these two pair of lines to taking first component. Now, I think this is essential point that we have a one-to-one correspondence between an oriented geodesic gamma in CP1, oriented geodesic as this. Gamma. Thank you. And almost complex structure Achilda in QP. QP is a quaternion Keras structure, where P is an element of this space, complex Grassmannian. You know. So to think about the converse of first theorem one, let phi denotes totally complex immersion from some complex n minus one dimensional Keras manifold sigma to complex plane Grassmannian, and let phi asterisk e to sigma be the pullback bundle of CP1 bundle of this one. And also we denote MR as a circle bundle over sigma such that each fiber of this fibration is the equidistance curve which is a circle from the geodesic CPN, CP1 corresponding to this this I tilde. Here, so as I told that each almost complex structure contained in Q5P, we have unique oriented geodesic, then taking equidistance curve. So MR is a circle bundle such each fiber is a this circle. So we have the following diagram. First, we think a totally complex immersion from Keras manifolds to complex plane Grassmannian. And also we have some CP1 bundle over complex plane Grassmannian. This is a CP1 bundle. Then we take a pullback bundle of E to sigma minus minus 1. Then also this is a CP1 bundle. Then by composing two maps, we know that this dimension of this space phi asterisk E and CPN is equal, coincide. Then since MR is a circle bundle, sub-bundle of this phi asterisk E, so dimension is of hypersurface. So if we take a composition of this map, we have generically real hypersurface from this totally complex manifold, where E denotes a bundle map. Hence, I told that phi r is defined by such a composition of above diagram gives a real hypersurface provided that phi r is an immersion. Of course, it may have some singularity, you know.
It's Gauss image of phi r is
ちょっと待って。ああ、これのガウスマップってことですか。Yes, yes, 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 yes. Yes, yes, yes. So to describe a result, we also need some notion about frame field of totally complex samples. For totally complex immersion phi, we have a local frame field G from sigma to unitary group.You know that a complex free glass manifold is a quotient manifold as a unitary group, you know, as a symmetric space. So we denote GP as current vectors, as an image. You know? And also, phi is a map from Keller manifold to complex free glass.Supreme glass manion, and so we take first two vectors as a basis of this two plane. Then the oriented geodesic in phi p, in phi p is also identified with CP1 corresponding to this complex, totally complex immersion, the I tilde is written as this form, where pi is a Hopf vibration. We denote omega ij as the components of the pullback of Morel counter form of unitary group with respect to this frame field. The second result is that let phi be a totally complex immersion from Keller manifold sigma toComplex plane glass manion, and suppose that the map, as we defined previously, from a map from MR, which is the circle bundle over sigma minus 1 to CPN is an immersion. Okay? Then the image of this map is a Hopf hypersurfaces in CPN, provided that with respect to components of pullback of Morel counter form,This equation satisfies. I don't know these equations are necessary to essential. If we remove or reduce these equations from other conditions, it is very best, but still I don't know. But in some sense, this gives a converse of theorem one.Now we only introduce only one example. A homogeneous hypersurface in CPN, we consider this one. This means that you know, the CPN is a quotient space of order dimensional 2n plus 1 dimensional sphere as a Hopf vibration, and since such product of order dimensional sphere lies inordination sphere, that by taking a quotient by unit complex numbers, we have a well-known homogeneous real hypersurface. So corresponding totally complex manifold in complex glass manion is a such sub-manifold. So next, we'd like to talk about a negative case, complex hyperbolic case.So it is well known that first we recall some realization of complex hyperbolic space as follows. Let C1 n plus 1 is a complex vector space with index 1 as a Hermitian scalar product space.And index 2 means that as a real scalar product space, which has also index 2, we define real valued in a scalar product as this form. Mm-hmm. Then the anti-Dojita space is defined by this equation. Then it is well known that anti-digital space is the principal fiber bundle of a complex hyperspace with structure group S1 and the fibration of this one. You know? This is an analogy of Hopf fibration. And let P be immersion from odd-dimensional manifold to complex hyperbolic space, and also let NP denote the normal vector. And as similarly, we consider this map. Here, PP is an element of CHN, and since pi is a projection from anti-digital space to complex hyperbolic space, then this vector lies in C1 n plus 1. So if we take a complex one-dimensional subspace spanned by this vector, this one, and also NP is, it is known that this is a space-like vector. So by taking direct sum, we have a Gauss map from this real hypersurface to indefinite. So, two-plane Grassmannian, you know, of real hypersurface in complex hyperbolic space. This means that a set of complex two-plane, such that each two-plane has a signature 1-1. You know. So, next to describe result. We'd like to introduce some structure on this indefinite Grassmannian. To do that, we recall some facts about real Clifford algebra. You know. So let V be a real symmetric inner product space of signature PQ, and we write inner product of this form. Then it is, you know that Clifford algebra CPQ is the quotient of a tensor tensor B divided by IB, where IB is a two-sided ideal in this tensor space generated by all elements of this form, you know. So we recall some Clifford algebras, CPQ with small PQ, which is that first, P equals 0 and Q equals 1 is nothing but the complex numbers, you know. So each complex number has this form, and so of course has no zero divisors. And so from this unit complex, if we take some a linear endomorphism J on some vector space or tangent space on manifolds, gives well-known structures such as almost complex, complex, or Hermitian Keter structures. You know? And so next, if we take P equal 1 and Q equal 0, such numbers called split complex numbers, or there are many numbers, names, hyperbolic number, Lorentz numbers, paracomplex numbers, which is written as this form, where J satisfies that J squared is equal to 1, and the norm is defined as follows. In this case, there is a zero divisor, so such number, set of such numbers is not a field, only ring. you may some facts in this Wikipedia page, you know. And also, from this J, if we take linear endomorphism J satisfying J squared is equal to 1. It is known that from this structure we have also important geometric structures such as almost product, paracomplex, para-Hermitian, and para-Keter. So next, so if we take P equal 0 and Q equal 2, then such number is nothing but the quaternions. You know? So it also it has no zero divisors. So similar to this IJK, if we take linear endomorphism on either vector space or tangent space, that gives the quaternion structure as previously. We note that if we denote V as linear space spanned by these three endomorphisms, then this space is naturally identified with a real algebra of SU2. And if we think natural inner product from Killing form, then this space is identified with R3. Then the space of I satisfying I square is equal to minus 1 is identified with two sphere in this space. You know, this is well known. So next, if we take P equals C to 0 or C 1 1, that space is called split quaternions, you know, which is also another name, co-quaternions or para-quaternions. Such number is written as this form. And so we'd like to note that only one I satisfies I squared minus 1, and also rest two elements, J and K, satisfy square is equal to 1. And these equations. Also, you can look at such facts in this Wikipedia piece. And I know that such numbers was initially introduced by these people in this year. So, according to that, we consider paraquaternion structure, which means that triple of some linear endomorphism satisfying the same, same equations as previously gives paraquaternion structure. And we note that let V tilde be a three-dimensional linear space spanned by these three endomorphisms, then this space is naturally identified with the real algebra of SU11. And if we take natural metric from Killing form, then this space is nothing but a Lorentz-Minkowski 3 space. And space of I satisfying square is equal to 1 is identified with Dojita space. And also, square is equal to minus 1 is identified with hyperbolic space. And nilpotent square is equal to 0 is identified with right cone in this space. So next, we introduce paraquaternion Kähler structures. You know, let M tilde 4M, G tilde Q tilde be a paraquaternion Kähler manifold with a quaternion, paraquaternion Kähler structure, G tilde Q tilde. That is a very similar to the previous quaternion Kähler definition. So, again, satisfying this equation. So, rest part is same as quaternion Kähler manifold, you know. So, complex 1-1 plane Grassmannian, indefinite Grassmannian, is an example of paraquaternion Kähler manifold, you know. So, also, next we think about sub-manifolds in paraquaternion Kähler manifolds. Let M tilde be a paraquaternion Kähler manifold. And even dimensional sub-manifold is said to be almost Hermitian or almost para-Hermitian if there exists a section I tilde of the bundle such that almost Hermitian if and only if square is equal to minus 1, and almost paramission in the case that square is equal to 1, such that tangent bundle is invariant by such structure, and so we denote by I the almost para complex structure on some out. It is from such structure. Next, MI with the induced metric G is an almost paramission manifold. If such manifold is either Kähler or para-Kähler, we call it a Kähler or para-Kähler sub-manifold. on Cotagnoni Keramah of M. Silla. This is also same as previously. We can define totally as a complex or part of complex semi-hots as previously. Okay. So, third result is that let M be a real hypersurface in complex hyperbolic space. And let G large B denotes the Gauss map of this hypersurface as defined previously. And suppose this hypersurface is a Hopf hypersurface, which means that each structure vector is an eigen vector of shape operator. Then the image GM of this Gauss map is a real 2n minus 2 dimensional semi-hold of this Grassmannian such that image is totally complex provided that mu is absolute value of mu is greater than 2. This is corresponding to the Montiel's result. And GM is totally paracomplex provided that absolute value of mu is less than 2. This is corresponding to Ibe's result. And intermediate case is that there exists a section, a chilla of the bundle, Q reselected to GM satisfying and the nilpotent and some hold is invariant under such tensor provided that intermediate case absolute value is equal to 2. So this is the result. Also, I of course think about the converse of this theorem, but still I'm checking. Today I don't talk previously, but I obtained some partial result of converse as previous bundle construction. And finally, we talk about some facts why these values, difference of these values give such phenomena, I think. So relationship between the values of Hopf curvature mu for Hopf hypersurface in CHN and behavior of each integral curve gamma of C is, I think, first, Hopf curvature is equal to zero. That means x is equal to zero if and only if we can easily see that integral curve gamma is a geodesic in complex hyperbolic space. And also, when the case, the value, absolute value lies in, is greater than zero and smaller than two, if and only if gamma is an equidistant curve from a geodesic in CHN, just like as Sokka. First we take geodesic, then move to each point to normal direction. Then we have such curves. And absolute value is equal to 2 if and only if gamma is a full cycle in CH. I should write that n is equal to 1, CH1. And also, in the case of absolute value is greater than 2, then such integral curve is a geodesic circle, which is a lowest dimensional version of geodesic sphere. So such behavior is, I think, corresponding to some relates to each structures. So I hope such consideration will apply many other some of the Hermitian symmetric space or like that. So I will stop here. Thank you.